think next speaker of the day is Hitesh. Thank you, Hitesh, for being here. I am very, very grateful. So let me tell you guys, how did I meet Hitesh? He is my COVID-19 friend, basically. We met during this time. And our friend Binayfer and many other people told him about me. And many people told me about him. And then we met. And jab we met, there was huge chemistry. And I just feel he's my brother from somewhere far off. Every time I meet him, I can actually sit down and joke with him, talk with him, and just be myself. And it's not very easy for being yourself with just everybody, but he brings that out in me. I also realize that he's got a lot that he can share with the world. This platform today has been created, and the inspirational stories have been extracted literally from people because they don't think they're inspirational. No. Inspiration, me? I don't know what that means. You know what? Each one of you is an inspiration. There's a story there of how you lived your 30 years, 20 years, 50 years, 60 years. And somewhere, I'm loving this more than even hearing about what you learned in a healing modality. Because healing is part of you. But I want to know you. If I know you, I know how you do your work. I know how you make that magic happen. And that's exactly how what we are going to find out from Hitesh. How did he make the magic happen? Where he's collected so many therapists under one roof called the Joining Hands. And how has he managed to join hands with so many people? And it can't be just coming from him. All the knowledge that I've got says that it has to be the ancestral tree standing behind him. So let's find out from him, ye raaz kya hai? So Hitesh, over to you.
Okay. Thank you for putting me in the spot. I love being in the spot. And now that I've told you my story, yeah, interesting. So, do you want me to talk about joining hands? Do you want me to talk about anything?
Yeah, let's start with the joining hands, okay. And let's tell people what that is about, and then I'll carry you through.
So I'm going to first show you these two lovely chairs. You see, I'm not sure if you can see these two lovely blue chairs.
Yes, we can.
Okay, so it all happened on those two chairs. And it's interesting because my wife told me one day that, Hitesh, we have a lovely sea-facing house and we need two chairs to sit down over there. And a small table that we can have a cup of tea looking at the sea every evening. So we started doing that. And interestingly, when we finally got the time to sit every evening and do that, that's when Corona happened. So this was early March. And Rosina was in a family constellation workshop. And she was in the workshop, no access to her cell phone. And Corona started picking up. And she told me, what do you need to do? So I said, I have absolutely no clue. But it started, we sat down one evening after her workshop, and we were talking about how people have been losing their jobs. So my wife, Rosina, runs a recruitment business, and she asked me to do a quick survey. So we set it up, and we saw that I think in 48 hours, close to 1,400 people had responded to that. And we said, 1,400 people having lost their jobs is crazy. What do we do? What can we do? And we said, maybe we can do one-on-one sessions, not charge people. So we did some math. If I could do 3 sessions a day and I could do, say, 21 sessions a week, I said, listen, by the time we actually get to the, like what happened, Anu, to you today, by the time you get to the last one, there'll be another 1,400 added every day. And the number was going crazy. And that's when we said that, listen, we both were talking and we said, really, there's something that can be done, to reach out to people, to create the awareness that there are so many therapists out there, there are so many people out there who really need healing, need to be aware and need help. And that's when we said, what do we do? Coincidentally, I had tried to do joining hands as a name with a different objective in 2017. So the domain remained with me. We had something of a website. The idea was to make a blog at that point of time. And we said, let's just do it. So we reached out to 10 friends. people like Chulin, Asha Warrior, people like Marion, who I knew one-on-one. And we said, would you guys want to come together and do these 10 workshops? And listen, it's going to be free. Don't ask me how it's going to be, you know, free, but we just need to keep it free so people can come and people can really understand that what it is to look. Because so the actual idea came from a friend of mine, because I was talking to him one day and he had lost his job because of COVID. And he says, Hitesh, my life is screwed. This is the fourth time I've attracted a horrible boss in my life. And, you know, this is the fourth horrible boss. And, you know, you just get horrible. And he added a little French language and a little words. And I know Anu is very comfortable talking about those words. But yeah, he uses some words which rhyme with C, some with F. And, you know, and he started addressing his boss. And I told him, if you've got four bad bosses, maybe it's a pattern. He says, yeah, Hitesh, I get you. It's a pattern. And I said, what's the learning? You know, and I'm here sitting, talking to him on the phone, hoping he has the Eureka moment. And he says, yeah, I think I need to avoid bad bosses. And I need to scrutinize my bosses better the next time I pick up a job. I mean, I was hoping I had a racket or a bat or a chappal or a shoe that I could pick up and hit him from the phone, saying that, listen, you asshole, if you've got four bad bosses, there's something you need to learn. And that's when we said that, listen, it's about time people understand that the journey is within. And the journey is never outside. And what do we do? So we put together these 10 people and we said, let's launch Joining Hands. We had no financial objective. We had nothing. In fact, Binayfa was our second speaker. Binayfa, you were our second speaker. And, you know, when we did this, the only learning I came with and the only understanding I had, I actually counted and I've launched 12 businesses till date. Out of 12, I mean, some have shut down, some I sold, some my partners took over and shut down. But we two continue to yet run beautifully till date. And they run my house and they run the family. I don't run any of them, incidentally. I just sit and, you know, enjoy life. Thank you, universe. But I realized that with every business that I did, I would go in with a business plan. And I love Excel. I mean, I love Excel. And I have this sheet that would run 3 years of business plans. And the, you know, you go into detail of planning, the intricacies of how every day will be, how the next work will be. And I did all of that. And unfortunately or fortunately, none of them worked like that. You know, and these are 12 plans that I made for myself. And because I was good at it, I think I made numerous plans for friends of mine also.
So Hitesh, take me back into your childhood and to your dad. Hmm. Because whatever you're talking today, we often believe, and whether it's family constellation, whether it's any healing modality, we often believe that you have a great relationship with your mom and dad, everything changes. Or even if you have a bad relationship with your mom and dad, everything changes. Mm-hmm. But it's not just mom and dad, it's also their mom and dad who were standing there.
Right.
So take me through a little bit of your childhood and a little bit about your mom and dad and your grandmom who was Gujarati. Just take us through that childhood time and let's see what's brewing there.
Yeah. So I think the first memory and the only memory that I the oldest memory I have is what I've been told is when I was born, my sister really wanted a brother and younger brother. And, you know, we have a 5-year age gap. And when she was asked, you know, in Hindus, we have this thing where you name the child with an alphabet. And she was asked, what would you want to name your brother? My sister said, Happy. You know, and I'm so glad today in some way that my name is not Happy. But I have no problem being called Happy. My wife, she keeps saying, Rosina keeps saying that I would definitely not want to be called Rosina Happy Bhatia. You know, so that's the oldest memory I have. And then life was good. Life was fantastic. I think I was this, my pet name was Tinku. So I was this scrawny little, really scrawny little thin child. And life was good. I used to be extremely playful, extremely energetic. Always just jumping around like a monkey everywhere. Till I got bullied very badly one day in my building compound by these big boys. And I decided never to go down and play. I don't even know that was a conscious decision. I think some part of me said, no, I think I'm done with that down there. And it was funny because when I look back at life, it was really hilarious. You know, you look back and you're like, oh my God, what was I even thinking? You know, they used to play hide and seek. And I remember this incident, 8:30 in the evening. And I'm looking entirely in the building. And I'm saying, where are these guys hiding? They're bloody good at what they're... You know, I think I was so naive. They're bloody good at hiding. And I've been looking at them for an hour. Till someone comes down and says, what are you doing? I said, I'm looking for them. They're like, dude, everybody's gone home. You know, this one's a quick one on you. And I look back and I'm like, oh my God, what was I really thinking? And what was I really doing in life? But that's the thing that I think that really shaped you and have shaped me to who I am today. So that was life. My grandmother was extremely loving. I think some part of her thought that I'm her ex-husband, my grandfather reincarnated. She loved my sister and me both, but she was extremely fond of me. And, you know, she always said that, you know, she always told me that I spoke about my past lives till the age of 10, which I have no memory of. But I do know that we have this steel intricate cupboard at home, which has got like those hidden vaults and hidden drawers. I think they've got some 72 hidden lockers inside it. And I'm the only one who knows the keys to all of them. And I'm the only one who knows where each of them are. Incidentally, it was gifted by my grandfather to my grandmother. So those are the things that I do remember. Life was really fun as growing up as a child. When I started getting bullied, I found solace in Archie Comics. And Archie Comics became my best friend. Archie, Stinkills, Amar Chitra Katha. And they became my best friend. I would sit down and read them hours and hours at a stretch. And my mom hated the fact that I wasn't studying. So every time she found, you know, my sister and I would hide them in various different places. We would hide them below the bed sheets, under the bed, because if mom found them, she would just pick them up and throw them away, saying that you'd rather be reading and studying. But we just didn't do that. Dad traveled a lot. So he traveled for work. And because I was bullied, and I found mom, you know, my grandmother was a Gujarati who did this morning prayer to God for almost 4 or 5 hours a day, where she sat down for Shinaji and you couldn't touch her. And she was in her space at that point of time. And I was running around house. And I found my solace in the kitchen, spending time with mothers, with mom sitting in the kitchen. And I think that's where my love for food really grew. Because, you know, we're an Indian household, it's a Punjabi household. Mom's job was to cook and dad was the one to earn. So mom would come up with these beautiful delicacies every day. And I would sit in the kitchen and learn how she would make all of them. Simple things like use your hand for spices. But I think that's where my love for cooking and that's where my love for my mother really grew. Where we would sit down and chat for hours. You know, when I'm sitting on the kitchen platform and she's cooking and while she's cooking, I would taste different things. Dad and I had a great bond, I think, all my childhood. Till I grew up and I think I became a rebel teenager. You know, when you see life, and I think I was sometimes rebellious, sometimes obedient. And I kept shifting between both of these roles very, very differently. My sister played a very important role in my life because Dad was away most of the times traveling. Mom came from a background where she was educated. But she was also controlled. So she kept telling us that, you know, I'm not going to control you and you live the life that you want to live. Which is, you know, the irony of today is my sister's married to a Catholic and I'm married to a Muslim. So, you know, in a Punjabi family, my grand... So it's just funny because, you know, that's how mom said. And my mother never really stopped us from doing anything that we wanted to do, whether it was drinking, whether it was... For smoking was a taboo because Dad had throat cancer, but we, you know, I was the only kid who was allowed to drink in my house at the age of 16. So all my friends would come over, you know, and smuggle all their alcohol that we had to drink and sit at my house and drink. And my mom was really cool about that.
So but tell that me, Hitesh, what is it that you specifically got from your dad? What is it that specifically you got from your mom, from your grandmom, and dad not being well, what did that teach you?
My grandmom, I think, gave me belief and trust. You know, and I don't think I knew that as a child, but now, you know, subconsciously, the always answer that comes is my grandmother trusted her God blindly. You know, and I, in fact, I was having this chat with someone today evening, and having this chat with Rosina in the evening again, and she said that I was talking about trust, and we said okay. So she said that some people are not sure about trust. And, you know, they're like halfway. So you just say, I trust, but not totally. And I said, that's not trust. The word trust itself means that you believe. You can't say, I don't believe. I believe half-heartedly. That doesn't make sense. So either you believe or you don't believe. Either you trust or you don't trust. So I think that's what came from my grandmother. From my mother, I think I've got the stubbornness.
Stubbornness for what?
Oh my God, for everything. if I want it, I mean, even if I have 1/10 of the stubbornness my mother has, oh my God. I mean, you know, she's fearless. Yeah. You know, she's fearless. And the stories we hear, I mean, she's absolutely fearless. You know, and it's funny because she's, at times she tells us that she wanted to be a police officer. And I said, my God, you'd have made a ferocious police officer. I mean, there would have been Kiran Bedi and there would have been Rekha Bhatia in Delhi, you know, sitting like that. We joke with her. And she's Punjabi, so she's, you know, she's, and I told you, Anu, like, staunch Punjabi, loud, fearless. And if it's to protect her children, my God, and protect her family, God have mercy, you know, even on those who come in front of her. Anyway, so that, I think that's what I've got. Of course, I've not got 100% of that, but I have got a lot of that. From my father, I think my father has been a charmer all his life. You know, he's had his way with people. And I think that's what I've got from him. I mean, he's got amazing willpower. I don't have patience. I mean, I have some, again, maybe I have 10% of what he has, but he's got willpower. And I told you about that, how after his operation, he survived 21 years.
Tell people, they don't know. Tell them what really happened to your dad.
So dad was always traveling and he had severe ulcerative colitis, which he yet suffers from. He used to smoke a box of cigarettes a day. And in 2000, he got operated for throat cancer. And Dr. Sultan Pradhan was one of the best surgeons in the ENT surgeons, oncologist globally. He had a tracheostomy in his throat, which is supposed to be there for 3 months. It's been 21 years. The tracheostomy yet remains in his throat.
So just tell people what is tracheostomy, because for people that's an alien story.
So they make a hole over here for you to breathe, and they put a pipe over here so that you can breathe from here. And Dr. Sonal is nodding; she's a doctor, so she probably knows this. You make a hole and you put a pipe over here for you to breathe, and it's normally a temporary procedure because you've had a surgery, and the windpipe and the food pipe is where this, you normally don't, you know, at times the. When the food and the windpipe get, basically you get confused. The air goes in through the food pipe and that gives you a coughing spasm. So they make a hole in the windpipe so you breathe from here and you don't breathe from here anymore. It's a temporary procedure, but the muscle that moves between the windpipe and the food pipe, there's a muscle that operates over here. So when you eat food, the muscle comes onto the food pipe and the food goes into the food pipe. When you breathe, the muscle moves onto the food pipe, so your oxygen goes into the windpipe. And it seems pretty simple, but it's a fairly complex procedure, which wasn't happening for him. The muscle just stopped functioning. And the doctor said that he's going to have the tracheostomy forever. And they put a pipe in his stomach, so he would have to be on a liquid diet forever. I think 3 or 6 months down the line, he said, dude, I'm not doing this. He said, I can't do this for life. So he found some kind of material to plug the tracheostomy and said, I'm going to start breathing from my mouth because it doesn't make sense to me. He started breathing from his mouth. And I think 6 months down the line, he said, I don't want this pipe in my stomach. So how you teach a baby to feed? He learned at the age of 57 to eat all over again. So he started by taking a spoon and drinking a sip of water. Because he would take the water and it would go down the food pipe. So he learned and he taught himself how to eat all over again. And today he's traveled to halfway across the globe. My sister's in the US, he goes frequently to see her. There was an incident last year where he went away and he didn't come home till 11:30 in the night and he freaked out what happened. But he said, yeah, I was at McDonald's and I felt like having a bite. And this is not a McDonald's somewhere around. I live in Kulaba and this is the McDonald's at Panvel. So those who've been to Pune, he wanted to see a piece of land. So he traveled all the way alone. And yeah, but he's got amazing willpower. Yeah. I don't even think I have 10% of that. And it's been 21 years and he's going strong.
So you never know whether you have 10% or 100%. But you do know that you've taught yourself to do many things like he did. And over again. Yes, And that definitely comes from the number of businesses that you've done. So could you take us through the number of businesses you've done? And you've taught yourself again and again to feed yourself again and again like a child. You've learned new businesses, knack in that, and really going further. Just take us through that, please. Thank you.
So my first business was when I helped. This was, I think I was probably 15 or 16.
Guys, he was 15. He was 15. He did his first business. 15, huh? How many of us do business at 15?
Easy. Okay. It was a funny thing. I started helping the elders in our life. And no apps, IPO forms come by post. DMAT accounts were a thing that weren't heard of. And filling up those IPO forms was a task. So I set up this desk in my society company and I said, I will help people fill up these forms. So that was the second business, was selling t-shirts in college. I would pick up t-shirts, get them printed, and with these crazy words and crazy things printed on them and sell them in college. And this was 2016-17. In 2017, I used to organize these events, call them socials. You know, there used to be a huge population. I mean, I don't know if the people over here, age group. But in Bombay, we used to have this discotheque culture in Bombay. And I can see Aarti nodding. And there used to be girls who weren't allowed late in the evening. So if you were a girl back then, and I'm talking about in 98, you had to be home at 8 o'clock in the evening. But people wanted to party. So we would organize this event calls, and from there I became a chef, and I've done so many crazy things there. You know, from being a chef to being a headhunter to being in logistics. Too much to talk about. I think to do rest. My last venture was where I did restaurants, and it's been a fun journey. I mean, each of them have taught me so much. And so many different things.
So can you take me through your catering experience where you were probably one of the very few men and a lot of women there? You know, it's generally the other way around. When a woman joins an engineering college in olden times, or IIT, IM, she's probably the minority there and all men. But Hitesh was just doing the opposite. He was going into catering, and in that process, he was the minority and majority were women. I think there is some disturbance with the internet, so you may have to close down, or maybe I'll have to close down my shutter.
We can hear you, Anu. We can hear you.
Okay, perfect. So could you just take me through what was happening in catering college? I just want people to get the flavor of that.
Yeah. So Binayfar has logged off. I was just checking. But Binayfar was my senior. And we were in college in Bombay, which is among the best college for girls. It's called Sapphires. And it probably has 5,000 girls. You know, and it's a beautiful college, beautiful architecture. You've probably seen it in a lot of movies. They have the main college, which has like probably 4,000 girls. And then they have the polytechnic, which has another 1,000 girls. And they just have one course that allows men. And that course is hotel management. So it's called the Hotel Administration and Food Technology. I can see Anu laughing, you know. And it was crazy. I mean, they were just being surrounded by 4,000 girls in a college. And with just what? Probably 50, 55 boys. So there was definitely no Eve teasing. There was a lot of Adam teasing, you know, and it was to be, it used to be fun. You know, I mean, there are some incidences I remember very clearly. Being a girls' college, a lot of girls from certain communities, I mean, specifically Muslim communities came there where the parents didn't want them to go to a co-ed college. But they came there and they came dressed in the morning in burqas, and you wouldn't know who they were. But you'd find them probably in a few minutes dressed, pretty modern, you know, because once you're in college, the your father, your parents drop you outside, the burqa goes away. We used to smoke back then. I remember sitting outside smoking, and these two girls walk up to you. Hi, Hitesh, how are you? And you're wondering, listen, I don't know you because you've got the burqa on and you don't know what happens. And then in the evening, they catch you. They're like, why didn't you say hi? I'm like, when did I not say hi to you? Said, you're sitting in the morning and smoking, and we said hi to you. And you said, listen, but I didn't recognize you. I didn't see you there. And they said, no, we were dressed in our burqa. So of course you wouldn't see us. But there were things like that. We saw very different kinds of, a very different kind of life over there. So it was very interesting because whatever we cook, we were also allowed to sell. You know, when we did cakes and then we did pastries, because you would cook these things and then you would have these sales. So it was just a very interesting journey to see how women were suddenly when they became free from where they were when they were in a controlled environment. But it was also very interesting to see how women responded to a minority of men.
So what did you understand from that about women?
I mean, I learned to respect women because I saw so many different, I saw them in so many different avatars. Because normally if you go to a particular college, you would find, if you're in commerce, you'll find, you know, if you're in a commerce college, you'll find women who are more driven to mathematics and that kind. If you're in an engineering college, you'll find women who are more driven to engineering. Here in one place, because it was a main college and there were so many girls, we found them all kinds. And in the polytechnic, we found there was, of course, they had hotel management, and then they had interior designing, they had fashion designing, they had mass media, they had journalism. So you saw the free thinkers, you know, the ones who came with nose rings and the boycotts, and the ones who smoked with you and drank with you, who were the mass media, who were the journalists, who were the free thinkers. Then you saw the ones who were in fashion designing, who really wanted to be prim and proper and came absolutely perfectly dressed. Then you saw the Muslim community who came from the Muslims, the Gujaratis, who came from a very conservative community, who didn't know of a world outside of the college, but who expressed very freely. So I think I learned to respect women in different ways. And I understood how everyone behaves. And you know, I think now when I look back at my life, specifically when I'm doing Joining Hands, I think all of these pieces contributed to the puzzle.
Obviously, has to be.
Absolutely. No, but you know, even when I've done various different businesses, even as a therapist, I look back at my life and I said, okay, there were so many things that I did, but they didn't, you know, what was the use of being a chef? What was the use of my being in hotel management or learning housekeeping? But when I look at Joining Hands, I can see every single thing that I did in my life fitting into place. It is like my entire life has been a preparation for what I'm doing today.
Wow, that's so satisfying and making you complete.
It is 40 years of doing everything, and I've done really odd jobs. I mean, I've sold T-shirts. I've cooked. I remember when I ran the restaurants and we didn't have delivery boys, I've done deliveries myself. And when you're short of staff, because of my culinary skills, I've gone into the kitchen and helped my staff cook. Because of my recruiting background, I've helped, you know, there were candidates who didn't join, who needed help. I've picked up my car and driven them from one place to go for the interview. So ferried candidates in my car, in my backseat to the interview. I've sat outside Haji Ali and smoked BDs with eunuchs, you know, and I've done some crazy things. But today, when I look back, I think it just all fits into so beautifully into place.
Hitesh, you were talking about from being bullied to becoming a bully. How did that happen, and what did you really do when you were bullying people?
When I was bullying people, I was mean, I was nasty. You know, but it's funny.
What did you do?
Why do you want to dig out things? Okay.
You know what? I want people to know that it's not, how do you put it? You don't have to have a life which means you're only going to sit down and pray for 50 hours and then you're going to make Joining Hands. Joining Hands happens when you totally know how to join every dot of your life, whether it is good, bad, ugly, beautiful khatta meetha. Khatta meetha means sweet or sour, when it's bitter. But together is the taste of the real wholesome food. So that's you.
I'm just smiling because all the memories of us bullying those kids have like flashing in front of us.
Okay.
We were mean boys. We were three friends, you know, from three different buildings. And we were really mean boys. You know, the only thing that I know that we were mean boys with a heart, which is, you know, the antithesis of everything. But it was like we bullied them, but we made sure we were the only boys who bullied them. So if there was someone else who was bullying them, we would go ahead and protect them, saying that, no, these are our bullies, only we can bully them. You're not allowed to bully them. But yeah, we've done mean things. Holi was like the worst thing for these kids. Yeah. You know, they would have eggs in all parts of their body. Our favorite was catching the boys, putting an egg in their pants and then bursting the egg. You know, then we would catch the young ones, pick them up like this and play the guitar with them. So, you know, they were like, and go headbanging on, you know, with the guitar with them. When the buildings were being renovated, and, you know, in the olden days, they never had tanks. So they would make these makeshift tanks. We would all pee in the tanks and then throw the boys in those tanks and then remove them and roll them in. I mean, they're just mean, nasty thing. But then, like I said, you know, we would play with them, but we also protected them. The good part is now, with Hope and Opino, I have done a lot of my cleansing. I have physically apologized to so many of them. And I've told them that if they ever need help, they can come and reach out to me. And I've told them that I used to be a mean boy and a nasty boy. And I've said that I'm sorry. A couple of them, interestingly, have become my clients. A couple of, you know, the other day, there were two girls in the building who came to me. And they, you know, there was a social gathering in the building, which is, again, not supposed to happen because of the lockdown. But she says, in my 31 years of living in this building, I'm speaking to you after 21 years. I said, why? She says, you are mean. And one day you just pulled us out of your house at some kitty party at home. And you say, I'm going to punish you girls. And I said, oh my God, I have no memory of that. And I sat her down and we had a lovely, lovely chat. I recommended a family constitution therapist to her. The next day, I did a beautiful Hope and Opino with her. Yeah, so there's a lot of cleansing happening. But we were mean boys. And I think, I don't know why we bullied. I think it was just our way of fitting in. Because when we bullied, we just saw, you know.
That's so beautifully said. That was my way of fitting in. And you know, guys, my research proves that if we get bullied, we become a bully. Because we know where the power lies. So, also going back to your catering college, you were probably like the Kanhaiya between the Krishna.
No. Not at all, in fact. I did have my way around women and I was a fair amount of charmer. But when I reached hotel management, I mean, it was a different world out there. There were just so many women out there. And coincidentally, something happened which I feel shouldn't have happened. I fell in love. So
talk about it.
It's just that's a part of my life I don't like talking about. I mean, it's over. It's done and dusted. But I have a policy where gentlemen don't talk. But I was madly in love. And things happened. I sort of said, okay. I had like the blinds that the horse has on. So that was...
Thank you for sharing that. That was it. You are very, very honest. And I really appreciate that about you.
Thank you.
And I will not dig there any further because the idea is not to make you uncomfortable. The idea is to all of you to know that a therapist can fall in love, a therapist can rag, a therapist can cheat, a therapist can be someone who grows from nothing and he's created so many businesses, he's done everything that is possible. And I want you to take us through one more journey where, you know, how did you meet Rosina?
Rosina is my wife, absolutely opposite of me. I mean, I don't think we have any similarities in life. I mean, yeah, there are similarities, like we both love reading.
Achha, pyar se bolna ki ye na ho ki iske baad teri thappad pade tujhe.
No, Rosina is a sweetheart.
Rosina, isko thappad wappad mat lagana, ye bahut sweet hai.
So she's not watching. She's pretty clear. She says, you do your things. I'm doing my thing. You know, you can do all the things that you want. So we like I said, we both are passionate about the alternate healing space. I love past life. She loves family constellation. So even there, we have our different paths. So this was around about 2002. Yeah, 2002. I was in a relationship. And I mean, since this is what we're talking about. I was dating a colleague I was 21, she was 29. So, I mean, it was fun. She was my senior, not directly reporting into her, but yeah, it was nice. It was fun. I mean, there was nothing serious, but we both were enjoying ourselves. And there was this want, I mean, I was very happy in the company that I was in, but because there was the want to make more money and grow, since she was at a senior position making more money, I decided to start looking out for a job. And I get this call, the word spread around, and I get this call from this woman that says, hey, are you looking for a job? And I said, sure, why not? I mean, I am exploring roles. I went for the interview. They loved me. Because I was the top performer in my company back then. They loved me. They wanted to hire me. They were giving me, I think at that point of time, an 85% hike on my salary.
Wow.
Yeah, because I was very clear. I said, the only reason I'm moving is if I get 100% increase, because I have a girl who I'm dating who makes more money than me. So I have to, you know, at least make more money. And I play the typical candidate. I didn't join for 3 months. I said, yeah, yes, no, yes, no, yes, no. And eventually I did. And Rosina kept on following up with me. The girl who called was Rosina. She kept on following up with me. And eventually we became friends because she would keep saying, when are you joining? When are you joining? When are you joining? I did join that company. By then I had, of course, broken up with her, with the other girl. And I joined that company and instantly Rosina and I became friends. I think we clicked because we both were really aggressive. And, you know, I loved how aggressive she was on the phone, following up constantly and talking. We both clicked. We both became very good friends. I joined the company. We both were most of the times the first people in office and the last to leave. And we both are workaholics. We loved working. It was a horrible company. Horrible, horrible company. Eventually, we got a new boss. We got a new CEO. And because we were a lot of young people in the company, we would eat lunch together. And we were both, you know, Rosina had a group of friends who would eat lunch together. And they would just lay out everything on the table and attack and eat everything. And I would like, because for me, food is sacrosanct. You can't do that to food. You have to sit down. And I love, you know, I loved what, I think Baljeet is also left. Yeah. But I think what he's.
Yeah. Bhupinder.
Bhupinder, sorry. Bhupinder said that you have to sit down, look at your food. Food is sacrosanct. It's next to God. So you have to enjoy and appreciate your food. And that's what he would do. And we became friends because I was setting up my team and she worked with me to set up my team. And, one fine day, Rosina, we had become really good friends. She avoided eye contact. And I was wondering what happened. You know, I mean, the 3-4 of us in the close group, wondering why is Rosina avoiding eye contact and what is she not looking at? Post-lunch, she's not joined us. Eyes are red. So we presume maybe kuch hua hoga. In the evening, we get to know. We've got a new CEO and things are moving nicely. In the evening, we're all asked to stay back at 6:30. All hands meet. All the team is asked to stay back. We're all chit-chatting, maybe new CEO, new strategies. Rosina walks in with a folder in her hand, bloodshot eyes, and we're wondering what's happening. And we all handed out pink slip that day. So the girl who hired me also fired me. You know, and she says, yeah. So she says, this is your last day of work. Thank you so much. The new CEO wants to bring in his team, doesn't want anybody of the old team. So you're hired and now you're fired. We said, thank you. And me being the eternal optimist, I said, okay, cool. Maybe now there's another chapter in our life unfolding. And we became friends and we had already become friends by then. Both of us felt that we were working really hard for asshole bosses. So we said that needs to change. And what do we do? So we really needed to meet and talk. We said, maybe it's time we start doing something on our own. Dadar station, for those of who are familiar with Bombay, Dadar station, platform number 6, the indicator has a bench below that. And I was out of a job. I mean, I was trying my hand at odd job. She had a job. So the only time we could meet was before and after her office. So she would come in a little earlier and we would sit on the bench, and I, after office, I would sit on the bench because that's where she would, you know, she would commute by train. And that's where we conceived the idea of doing a business together. So, you know, that, that bench for us was, again, became very important. We would sit on the bench in the evening. And then, of course, I had no money and she was yet earning. So she would, when, you know, I would wait for her to come if I was hungry, and then she could buy, pay for the food. And we became very extremely close friends back then. And I think back then what really you know, connected both of us, we both were extremely aggressive. Extremely aggressive. The wants to make money, the wants to do more, the wants to build an organization where the bosses aren't assholes, basically. And I think that was a driving factor. We launched two businesses in 2003 with no money. And I think the rest is history, because we launched the business. We would, I strongly believe if it's for you, the path becomes so easy. The universe just makes it for you. You have to trust, and the universe just makes the path so easy for you. No money, an uncle gave us an office to use for free. You know, and we just started from that office. Life became really interesting. Things started flowing into place really easily. Of course, there were our hurdles. We would be in office at 8 o'clock, work till 10 o'clock in the night. And as we started working, Diwali, Christmas, New Year, every single day, birthdays and, you know, parents' anniversaries, whatever it was, cousins' wedding, we said, screw it, we need to work. Because we both really liked working, and we would just be there every single day, Saturdays, Sundays included. At that point of time, I think because there was nobody else, we both started getting infatuated with each other. We started having this liking for each other. And that's when we started falling in love. And we fell in love at that point of time. And eventually, the story goes that I wanted the entire business and all the money to come home. I said, why am I letting 50% go to her house? So let the entire money come home. But no, the truth is that we both were really in love with each other. And we both realized it's going to be fun. Of course, as we started the journey, we thought, listen, we're not going to be able to get married. You're Muslim, I'm Hindu. Or you're Hindu, I'm Muslim. The parents will never accept. But I think we're just, again, both our parents had absolutely no objection. And it's hilarious because she comes from an Orthodox, fairly conservative family where she is the first intercaste marriage in generations. I mean, that we know of. From my end, my sister had got married to a Catholic and things were more open. And but my mother had made me swear that your daughter's married a Catholic because it's a love marriage. You have to marry a Punjabi. You have to, you know, and my mother is very, very, very Punjabi-ish. So you have to climb on the horse. You have to do the entire feras. And it has to be a classical Hindu wedding. And, you know, much to her agreement, we had no feras. We had no horse. We had a plain and simple court marriage, followed by a beautiful reception where I ate like, you know, I mean, I the food was so amazing. I had to do justice to that. You know, my friend did the catering.
Ate properly at his wedding.
You know, my friend was the one who did the catering, and he comes to me and he you know, he puts his arm around me. He uses a few lovely words for me and he says, you're the only doula. He said, I must have done maybe 2,000 plus weddings. You're the only groom who's ever eaten like that at his own wedding. And I said, dude, the food is so amazing. I mean, what do I do? Wow. You know, the mutton rogan josh, I yet can savor the taste of the mutton rogan josh.
So tell me before we basically call it the end of this talk, what has been a motivational story for you? What caught you between all these different phases of life, from being in a college which was unconventional? And I do remember you telling me a story of your boss throwing you in front of about 2,000 people and 900 people, to life throwing you in front of 5,000 women, to you jumping between different businesses, to you having a dulhan who is a Muslim, and with so many different varieties, and you having studied in Netherlands and having done Tasso, what would you say is a thought or a psyche or your attitude that keeps all these things, all these parts of you together?
I think it's blind trust. You know, and for me, it's funny because not many things you remember from your school, from the books that you study. And we used to have, I don't know why, but we used to have these books called Moral Science. There should be a subject called Moral Science. And it used to be damn irritating because they were really boring stories. And you had to see the moral of the story at the end of the day. And, you know, you never understood back then that how does this moral really relate to the entire story? I mean, you were probably 12, 13, 14-year-old kids who only bothered about when is the next lunch break for me to go play. But I don't know which story it was, and I don't know what it was, but the moral that remained was trust begets trust. There's a story that said trust begets trust, and the moral was trust begets trust, and that just somehow stuck with me, Anu. You know, that just somehow stuck with me so deeply, because I constantly went back and I said that, how can you expect someone to trust you if you don't trust that person? And you have to make the first move. And I think with sales, you know, and everyone says I've been cheated and I've been broken. And I says, yes, but you also look at logic that you have five fingers. Just because someone broke your heart doesn't mean the next one who comes will break your heart. If someone cheated on you, doesn't mean the next person who walks in will cheat on you. And you have to take every day with blind eyes. Absolutely blind faith and blind. And you will get cheated. Fantastic if you get cheated. And it's okay to be okay for your trust to be broken. But that doesn't mean that the next morning you get up and say, my trust was broken. I am not going to let trust again. No. You get up every morning and you say, I trust this day is going to be the best day of my life.
Wonderful. You have a song, a Hindi song or an English song, which is your favorite one, and that you kind of talk about in your head sometimes. You know how it happens, that there could be a song, there could be a movie that motivated you, and it just stayed in your head. And koi gana, koi some quote, something like that.
I'm very filmy. I mean, I'm Bollywood filmy to the core.
But
I don't have happiness. You know, there are so many of them, but I'm going to say three then.
Okay, done. Three. No, three no. Guys, three. He doesn't three. Do anything in one. He doesn't do anything in one. Three.
I do wife in one. One wife. So, you know, as filmy as it can get, Shah Rukh Khan says
that was getting.
I'm just pulling his leg, guys. I'm muting you all. And then I'm going to mute everybody so you can unmute yourself again, Hitesh. Yes.
So, I think as filmy as it can be, with Shah Rukh Khan saying that, agar tum kisi cheez ko chahte ho,
if you want something.
Something. So I'll say it in English. If you really want something, then and if you really want it with all your heart, then the universe will do whatever it is. And the universe will work to ensure that you get it.
You know, and agar, Om, you know, Shanti Om.
Om Shanti Om. So like I said, very filmy as it can get. But I strongly believe that if you really want something, it will come to you. The only cliche to that is it'll come to you when the time is right for you. So it might not come to you today, but it will come to you when the time is right for you.
Absolutely.
Well, and it could be this life or another life, but it will come to you.
Bilkul.
Yeah, that was the one. The second one is I love Disney. I hate the fact of the subliminal advertising that they do, but I loved it. I think he's one of the most beautiful. There are two beautiful storytellers of our generation. One is Walt Disney, the other is Steve Jobs. No one tells stories the way they do. And Kung Fu Panda, there are no accidents. There are absolutely no accidents in your life. Everything that happens in your life is part of your life plan. Knowingly, unknowingly, there are no accidents in your life. You know, and the third thing that a song, since you asked, I mean, I love singing, so I mean, I can, and I'm not very good at it.
Gade.
But it's more like a poem.
Guys, all of you unmute yourself and say, please.
I will sing it. I have no problem.
Please, Hitesh.
I will sing it. I'm singing
please,
it.
Please,
no
please,
problem.
Do.
I have no problem singing it. I'm not sure if it's a song, but it goes like Earth, my body, water, my blood, air, my breath, and fire, my spirit. Earth, my body, water, my blood, air, my breath, and fire, my spirit. Earth, my body. It's a small verse, but it really resonates with everything that life is about for me. You know, and that's what life is about. Earth is, you know, body is earth. You know, earth, my body, water, my blood. The blood that I have in me is water, which is in the universe. Air, my breath. The breath that I breathe is nothing but the air that the universe has. And the fire that's in the universe is part of my spirit. So that's the only song. Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Wasn't he amazing, guys? Wasn't he amazing? And we will have questions for him if he stays, but he wakes up at 4 o'clock in the morning. And I really, really appreciate that he has stayed awake for so long. And if you can wait for a little while more for my next speaker, sure. And if we can then have question answers, because if we do have question answers now, everybody will sleep. It's already 11:12. So thank you, thank you, thank you so, so much. I really, 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 really appreciate it.
Thank you.
Bahut shukriya. Badi meherbani.